Should we destroy and remake our cities? I was kind of delighted to see that question in the comments a couple videos ago, because it perfectly encapsulates both the high stakes and the high anxiety surrounding redesigning cities for full sustainability. This question comes up because it's really clear that cities are poorly designed, and that poor design has made them probably the biggest environmental threat in the world. Now, dealing with that threat involves change, and change is scary. Change can involve loss and destruction, and that can cause lots of grief and lots of anger. These are things we would like to avoid. So do we really need to destroy our cities in order to rebuild them? Short answer, no. But the full answer is a little more nuanced. Welcome to Edenicity, Best Practices for Sustainably Abundant Cities. Let's start by talking about what's wrong with cities in the first place. First of all, cities are terrible for the environment, at least the way they're designed right now. They contain half the population of the world, but produce more than half of the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. They have long-distance supply chains that hide the true costs of fuel-powered agriculture, mining, and waste disposal. They are sprawling, noisy, wasteful, and polluting, all of which are terrible for the environment and play a significant role in causing mass extinctions. Cities are also kind of terrible for people, at least the way they're designed right now. The main thing that's wrong with cities is that they are now mostly car-centric, and this has made it extraordinarily difficult for a large chunk of the population, usually segregated along racial lines, to climb out of poverty. The average new car in the United States is $43,000. So in cities like Columbus, where you need a car to get to work and to basically function day to day, a fairly large fraction of the population is permanently hobbled. Car dependence is also a very costly public health problem, as I discussed in this video. Okay, so we know cities are bad. How should we redesign them? Well, I think it's fair to say that if we can, we should redesign them to end the mass extinction, which inevitably will affect our food sources, and do so in a way that makes us more, not less, prosperous. Our main tool is going to be shrinking our land use, and when we do that, the efficiencies that come into play all work in our favor. They all increase livability and reduce cost. Now, the Edenicity model to accomplish this is fairly simple. We build neighborhoods to be car-free, mixed-use, multifamily, garden-to-cafe. And doing this alone shrinks our land use by 96%. At the scale of cities, we add transit-oriented design, where we build our mixed-use housing close to transit stops, and food and energy security. And as I showed in this episode, that can cut our land use by up to 98%. Now, how do we get there? I mean, do we need to just tear everything down and start over again? Actually, that's not necessary at all. It turns out that cities are constantly tearing themselves down and rebuilding, and world cities are growing. Let's talk about how cities are rebuilding. I'm going to focus on houses, cars, and roads. Houses, depending on who you talk to, last anywhere from 40 to 100 years. So by 2050, at least 26% of existing housing in cities will be replaced, meaning they will hit their expiration dates and be torn down for something that takes their place. And chances are it will be much more than 26% due to natural disasters, financial meltdowns, and social change. Just to give you a sense of how big the financial disruptions can be, I remember in 2008 driving through entire suburban subdivisions in central Ohio that were completely boarded up. These were McMansions that were really pretty fancy, that had been built in the preceding 10 or 20 years, that were now just falling into disrepair. The lawns had gone to seed, the grass was 6 feet high, there was already visible damage to the roofs and windows. I mean, it was shocking. And this is what can happen to large numbers of houses and large portions of cities in a relatively short time. Huh, was it 2008? It might have been 2009 or 10. Anyway, it was around the time of the housing crisis. So by 2050, let's just go with that lowest figure of 26% of the housing needing to be replaced by then. That's going to be, for a city of, let's say, 1 million people, a cost of $47 billion to rebuild, and probably a lot more. What about roads? Every road in America will need to be resurfaced 2 or 3 times by 2050, and about half of them will need to be repaved or rebuilt entirely. By 2050, this process for a city of 1 million people will cost about $16 billion. What about cars? It might seem strange to count cars as part of city infrastructure, but when you consider them as part of the transportation infrastructure, I think it's fair. These days, cars last about 12 years. So every car on the road today will be replaced 2 or 3 times by 2050. For a 2-car household, this works out to about half the price that they paid for their house. When you sum up the total cost of car ownership for a city of 1 million people, it adds up to a whopping $260 billion by 2050, which is an order of magnitude more than a typical transit system of $10 or $20 billion. So to sum up, cities are constantly rebuilding, and it costs really big money. Here in the United States, the rebuilding that naturally occurs in cities will cost $275,000 per person by 2050. So just keep that in mind. In addition to that, cities are growing. According to the United Nations, the global urban population is growing by 200,000 people a day, every day, from now through 2050. A relatively recent report showed that we're also likely to see 200 million poor people fleeing climate change by 2050, and an untold number of affluent people fleeing as well, as people from the US West Coast in particular start to migrate inland. When growth is poorly planned, you end up with car-dependent sprawl. Here in Columbus, which is looking at a lot of growth, we're looking at a second highway ring around the city, which would be an absolute disaster for the environment and for people, because it would lock people for whom a car is too expensive into just grinding poverty and limit their options. In very rapidly growing, poorly planned cities, you see rings of peripheral shanty towns, squatter encampments near the urban cores, terrible squalid neighborhoods that nobody wants to go to and people can't escape from. While cities in general will grow, there will be winners and losers. There will be cities that depopulate, and this is absolutely catastrophic for cities. In 1950, for example, Detroit had 1.9 million people. Today, it has 630,000 people. This has been a slow-moving disaster for the city because with the erosion of the tax base, the ability of the city to supply basic services is diminished. And as that happens, more and more people want to flee. So to sum up, the status quo in cities is destructive and costly. In the US, it's going to cost at least $275,000 per person, and it's terrible for people and terrible for the environment. So given that cities are already constantly rebuilding and constantly growing, Edenicity provides a strategy for them to do these things in a way that helps the environment and people in truly significant ways. Edenicity is the strategy that comes before the detailed planning and zoning. It's a clear goal to steer toward so cities can rezone and transition property when it becomes available and repurpose roads when they need repair. It also provides a sustainable pathway for ambitious developers. For an example of how this might work, check out these videos, and I'll also link them in the description. Take care, stay green, see you next time.